James Day, public television pioneer and chairman of the CUNY TV Advisory Board, passed away in April 2008. His legacy includes the series Day at Night, which aired for 130 episodes beginning in 1973. The program features interviews with many of the great thinkers and achievers of the 20th century. These 30-year-old programs have been restored. The interviews remain fresh and relevant today, exploring issues that are still important to society. Showing them again is CUNY TV's tribute to Jim and his contributions to public television.
Richard Rodgers has probably written more songs sung by more people than any composer in history. Over a period of 50 years, he's produced an incredible treasury of some 40 musical shows, 29 of these in collaboration with lyricist Lorenz Hart, with whom he wrote such popular classics as My Funny Valentine, The Lady is a Tramp, and Bewitched, Bothered, and Bewildered. Another two decades of partnership with Oscar Hammerstein II resulted in some of the greatest musicals of the American theater, among them Oklahoma, South Pacific, Carousel, and The Sound of Music. The honors and awards heaped upon Richard Rodgers reach at least as high as an elephant's eye. Pulitzer Prizes for Oklahoma and South Pacific, movie Oscars for the song It Might As Well Be Spring and the motion picture version of The Sound of Music, television Emmys for the music to Victory at Sea and Winston Churchill, The Valiant Years, and Tonys, Grammys, and Drama Critics Circle Awards without number. Perhaps his greatest reward is the almost incontrovertible fact that at this moment, someone, somewhere, is playing, singing, or humming a Richard Rodgers tune. Many a new day will Mr. Rodgers, is a collaboration between a lyricist and a composer in any sense like a marriage?
Well, it's curious that you should say that because you're absolutely right.
Is it?
Yes.
There's no courtship, of course, is there?
Yes.
Yes, sir?
There can be. Mm-hmm. When you find a lyric writer with whom you'd like to work, you have to court him, and he has to court you back.
It works both ways.
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm.
There are lyricists looking for composers, as there are composers looking for lyricists.
Right, mm-hmm. Right. Just as there are actors looking for jobs and managers looking for actors. Mm.
Does it have some of the same stresses and the same joys of sharing that I suppose a good marriage would have?
Yes, but a good collaboration in writing doesn't depend much on stress. It depends more on an absence of stress. On getting along, on understanding each other. Mm-hmm. And I think the one way to handle that is to do the Alphonse and Gaston act.
What's that? You mean after you?
We'll do it your way.
I say. You both say that.
Yes, I think this is the ideal situation, mm-hmm. and I've had it. Mm-hmm. You say, we'll do it your way. And he says, no, we'll do it your way. And then it works out very well.
Huh. Two of the people you have worked with, Hammerstein and Sondheim wrote the lyrics first, and then you wrote the music. But all the early years of your composing with Lorenz Hart, you wrote the music and then he wrote the lyrics. Is that right?
That's right.
Did it make a difference to you as a composer which came first?
No, it still doesn't.
Didn't the lyrics in some way suggest the music to you?
Yes, in that way it's a big help. Mm-hmm. But it also is confining to a certain degree.
Is it? I mean, the meter is set for you, so you have to write to that meter?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But I find that the advantages outweigh the disadvantages.
The advantage of having the lyric?
Having the lyric. Uh-huh. it sets you going, gives you something to write to and about.
How do you get going when you begin with the music first, as you did for 20 years? Do you have tunes that you store up in your head, so to speak?
No, never.
Never?
Never. I've never had a tune put away.
Does the situation, the title, suggest the
kind of... It can be the title, can be the scene, can be the situation within the scene, it can be the characters that you're writing for. There are many things that suggest music.
And do these suggest rhythm to you as well, a certain kind of rhythm for a certain kind of situation, or...
Well, rhythm is a third of music. It's part of it. Mm-hmm. And of course, there's harmony and melody, and they're all suggested by these things that I just mentioned, mm-hmm. character and the situation.
It's been written about you that you write very fast.
This is something of a canard that was started by Mr. Hammerstein, who was very slow.
I see. So you wrote very fast in comparison,
to
his writing,
to him,
I see.
Yes. But I must say, I write rather quickly. Mm-hmm.
Does the music come to you more or less spontaneously?
Yes, if I get some sort of propulsion from the words, then it comes quickly.
The story is told that Hammerstein sent you the lyrics for Bally High while you were at a dinner party, and that you wrote the music for that in something like 5 minutes. Is that also a canard, an apocryphal story, or? Was it 10?
It's semi-apocryphal.
I see.
We were at lunch at Josh Logan's, and Oscar came in, and at the lunch table, handed me the lyric of Bally High. And I left the room and thought about it for a few minutes, and then went to the piano and I had the tune. But why I say it's semi-apocryphal is because nobody realizes how much goes on inside your head.
There's a period of gestation then?
Exactly what it is. And it can last months. It did with Bally High.
You mean you had that tune more or less?
No, I didn't have the tune. I didn't have a note of it. Mm-hmm. But I had the subject. I knew about the island. I knew about the woman who used to sing it. And I knew all the time the type of music I wanted. So that when it came down to doing the actual writing, I was pretty well prepared in my head, which made it seem very quick and somewhat miraculous. It wasn't at all. I've been doing my unconscious homework.
But even so, you've never had to struggle for a tune over any period of time, and you've turned out well over, 2,000 tunes? And
I don't know.
You don't really know?
No. It's somewhere up in 1,000 or more.
But you never found yourself repeating or coming back to a familiar level?
Yes. Oh, sure.
You do.
But as soon as I realize that it's a repetition, I throw it away. Mm-hmm. Just as very often I find that the phrase, the musical phrase, sounds like something someone else has written. I throw that away. And it usually occurs to me before it gets produced.
Is there a difference in the tunes that you wrote for Lorenz Hart and those you wrote for Hammerstein? It's been said that Hart's lyrics were witty and romantic, and that Hammerstein's were homey and romantic. That does this affect the composer?
Well, surely it does.
So it's a different kind of music. There is a distinction between the two kinds of music, depending upon the lyricist, then.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Depending on the subject matter, which, after all, comes from the lyricist.
Yes, that's right. So obviously the music is set to the subject. Music, I gather, has been a part of your life since virtually the time you were born. You grew up in.
Well, within music a couple of years of it.
Yes. Your mother was a pianist?
Yes, not professional. Mm-hmm. But she played beautifully. She was the best sight reader I ever knew. Mm-hmm. And my father loved music.
Although he was a doctor?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of doctors do like
it. Of course.
Someone has said the best place to have a heart attack is at Philharmonic Hall.
Because of the doctor's presence.
Oh, there's sure to be a doctor in the same row as you.
Absolutely. I understand that they both loved the musical theater and attended it frequently.
Yes.
And that you were a part of this at home when you were 2 and 3 years old.
Well, the piano was where we met before dinner, and it's where we went after dinner. And there was music every day, every day, every day. And curiously, it was show music.
It was show music?
Yes.
Do you recall the shows?
Yes. Merry Widow was a little early for me to recall, but shows like Chocolate Soldier, Pink Lady, a great many of them, I can picture the score. They always sold the printed score in the lobby of the theater, and my parents used to buy it and bring it home, and up it would go on the piano. And my mother would play it again and again and again, starting with the overture. Not doing the whole thing in one night, but eventually reaching the exit march.
And your father sang?
My father sang, not very well, but with love.
Did you, as you were growing up in those early years, and taking the piano, not taking the piano, but playing the piano by ear, did you have your own favorite composer that influenced you at all?
Not in the early years. I had to get into my early teens before I had a favorite.
And who was that?
Jerome Kern. I think he was the father of a lot of us. He started the whole thing going.
You were playing the piano at the age of 6, were you not?
Well, I was trying to before that.
And before that, at 3, you played with one finger, I gather, so apparently it came quite natural to you to pick up tunes easily and to play them on the piano. And you were composing tunes at the age of, what, 9?
Or around in there, I don't remember exactly. But I was very young.
Do you recall what your first composition was?
Well, something called the Auto Show Girl.
Do you remember today how that tune goes?
I'm afraid I do.
You were, what, 14 years old when you
composed
that?
About 14,
that,
yes. Huh?
Was that for an auto show?
No, it was about an auto show.
Oh, I see.
See, in those days, you tried to pin a song on something that was going on. And the auto show was a yearly event, and that was a natural one.
You were also composing, as I recall, in the camp where you went in Maine about the same time.
Campfire Days. That was the name of the masterpiece that I turned out.
Your first score, for a full score, was for about the age of 15, wasn't it, with the Akron Club, which was, an athletic club that your brother belonged to.
Yes, I was too young to belong to the club.
You were, but not too young to compose for
Not too young to write their show for them.
And then what? Your next show was at with Hart, was it not? About the age of 16. When did you first meet?
I met Hart when I was 16.
When you were 16, and
yes,
he was a bit older.
23.
Where did you meet?
We were introduced by a mutual friend. A fellow knew that Larry needed a composer, and knew that I needed a lyric writer, and he took me up to the Hart place on 119th Street. One Sunday afternoon, and we worked together from then until he died.
That was in 1943.
Yes.
And I found a quotation where you are at least quoted as having said, "I left Hart's house having acquired in one afternoon a career, a partner, a best friend, and a source of lasting irritation."
That's right.
What was the lasting irritation?
The fact that I could never find him.
Over all those years, you had
something to call? Over all those years, he would disappear. And he had to be found, and he had to be locked up in a room, and I had to stay there with him until he wrote.
Your first show together was the undergraduate varsity show at Columbia, wasn't it? Or did you write before that time?
Well, I didn't write a show before that.
Yeah. You wrote a musical number together before that time, though, didn't you?
Yes. A number called Any Old Place With You.
That wasn't a Broadway show, though, was it?
That was interpolated in a Broadway show.
So the first score that you wrote together then was the undergraduate show at Columbia. And you went to Columbia, I understand, for the purpose of writing the varsity show.
Well, I don't know that I went there with that as a purpose. But it certainly attracted me to Columbia because they did very good shows, did them well, had a large professional orchestra. And we ran a full week at the Hotel Astor in the ballroom. which was convertible to a stage.
What was that first show?
It was a show called Fly With Me.
Sounds like a contemporary phrase, Fly With
Me.
Well,
the curious thing is that the action of the show was set in 1970-something, which would make it now. This was our idea of what the world would be like 50 years from then.
That show, Fly With Me, was an opening for both you and Hart, was it not, through Lou Fields?
That's right. Mm-hmm. He produced a show called The Poor Little Ritz Girl, R-I-T-Z, girl, and used our score as a basis for his show, and then I had to share it.
You had to share it?
With Romberg.
Sigmund Romberg.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that was the first show?
That was the first professional show.
That you did, and that...
Yeah, I was pretty old by then. I was 17.
17,
yeah.
Your first professional show went on Broadway.
Yeah.
But then, after that, you were riding pretty high at that point. After that, there were some leaner years, were there not?
Well, they were leaner in a monetary sense. And professionally, I was happy because I was going to the Institute of Musical Art, which is now the Juilliard, mm-hmm. and studying theory.
Is this the first time you studied music in a formal sense?
Yes.
After you'd written your first Broadway show?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Why did you study?
What did I?
Why did you go to school to study?
Well, to begin with, I wanted to learn the names for all the things I'd been doing all my life. No, I went there because I wanted to learn music. Just being able to write some tunes didn't seem to be enough. Mm-hmm. And I went there and I learned more at the Juilliard, the Institute, than I ever did in high school or college.
Mm. How long were you there, 2 years?
I was there 3 years.
3 years.
You know, the second two were on scholarship.
And then during this time, you were not writing any successful Broadway plays.
No, I couldn't get one.
Couldn't get one.
I was trying.
Is it true that you almost took a job as a children's underwear salesman at this point? Because...
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, a nice man offered me a job working for him. And the salary was $50 a week.
That looked good then, I suppose.
That was tremendous then. And I told him I'd let him know the next day. And that night, at home, I still lived with my folks, of course, I got the offer to write a review for the Theatre Guild. And I took it, instead of...
This was a non-paying job, too, was it not?
Well, no, nobody ever knew.
Oh.
The Guild wanted to buy tapestries for their new theatre. They thought they would put on a little amateur show, semi-professional show, to run a Sunday afternoon and a Sunday night. And I wrote it for them.
This was the KQEDs.
This was the KQEDs.
Lyrics by Hart again.
With lyrics by Larry. And the song hit is still played today.
Which one's that?
Called Manhattan.
Mm-hmm. And that that semi-professional show to run Saturday and Sunday ran for how long?
Oh, the better part of a year. I don't know exactly how long, but it was a big hit.
Mm-hmm.
And Larry and I took off then.
And within,
everything came together.
Yes, within a couple of years, you had three successes running on Broadway at the same time.
Yeah.
And you were how old? 23 at the time.
22.
Did that affect your life to have three big successes at the age of 22?
Certainly it did. Affected it very pleasantly. All very cozy. I loved it.
Mm. And over the years, through the 20s and the 30s, every year was a new show and sometimes two and three shows in a year.
Yes, that's true. Mm-hmm. I remember there was one year when we wrote two shows and a third one in England. didn't want to flood the market.
Is that why you did the three shows?
I don't know.
There came a point where your collaboration with Larry Hart began to, I guess, fall apart in about 1941, 42, somewhere there, because of the reasons, I suppose, that you've mentioned earlier. Difficulty in finding him?
Yes.
And you went to Oscar Hammerstein. I didn't realize that you'd known him at about the same time you knew Larry Hart.
Oscar first.
Did you know?
I met him first. Mm-hmm. He was in a Columbia Varsity show.
I see.
And my brother went to Columbia, and he took me to see a performance of the Varsity show that Oscar had written the words for, mm-hmm. and in which he appeared. And after the matinee, my brother introduced me to Oscar, who swears I was in short pants, and I swear I wasn't.
What finally caused the breaking between you and Larry Hart? It was about the point where Oklahoma was written, wasn't it?
Before.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted Larry to work on it.
On what was then the play Green Grow the Lilacs. We sometimes forget that since Oklahoma's become so famous that it was from that play. He didn't want to work on it, I gather.
He wanted to go to Mexico. He wanted to take a vacation. Mm. And I told him if he didn't stay home and work, I was going to Oscar. And he told me I was right. He didn't blame me a bit. So I did. I had to. Mm. And from the beginning, Oscar and I hit it off beautifully. Enjoyed working together.
What were the qualities that made that partnership such a highly successful one?
Oh, I suppose the inside things that we each brought to it. Mm-hmm. And we hit it off terribly well. We understood each other. I knew what his words meant, and I felt that I could match them.
What were the first words he ever submitted to you? Do you recall?
Yes. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. And that was the verse of Oh, What a Beautiful Morning. Mm. That was the first song we wrote together.
Do you recall your reaction when you saw that lyric for the first time?
No, I had to get to a piano to it. There's another case of it, of the lyric propelling the composer into a musical situation. You couldn't resist those words. They were so lovely. And musical, and theatrical.
Then over the 20 years that you worked, almost 20 years with Oscar Hammerstein, you turned out all those wonderful musicals. Were any of them a surprise to you in terms of their success, like Oklahoma? Was it a surprise when Oklahoma was such a huge success?
Well, that would surprise anybody.
It would?
A success, mm-hmm. those proportions. Mm-hmm. It was very big right from the beginning. It was very big before it opened.
So you knew it was going to be successful the night it opened?
I was sure of it. Mm-hmm. I don't know who else agreed with me. Oscar had had a bad time. The Theater Guild had had a bad time. Agnes DeMille, who did such a wonderful job, had never had a Broadway show. Mm-hmm. And nobody expected the show to work. But we had a run-through one time when we were in rehearsal. And my wife was there. And we all wanted to get together and talk after the show, that is the staff. So I put my wife in a cab and sent her home. And I got home about 3 hours later. And there was a little note on my pillow. It said, "Darling, this is the best musical show I've ever seen." I had some idea that we'd hit it.
Yes. Do you trust your own judgment on your own tunes when you've finished? Do you know instinctively this is what you want, what the audience will want?
I can't vouch for the audience.
But for yourself, you know.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Have you ever been wrong with respect to the audience and what you thought they, how they might react, and they haven't?
You mean in a given tune?
Yes. Anyone that you had doubts about that proved to be a big hit with the audience, or one that you particularly liked that the audience didn't accept?
Oh, that happens a lot.
It happens a lot?
Yes. Mm-hmm. But then it's awfully hard to be objective mm-hmm. about your own music.
Do you enjoy hearing your own music?
Tremendously. I love it.
You're writing a show now.
Yes.
For fall of 74, about Henry VIII.
That's right.
How do you go about, are you at the stage yet where you know what the lyrics are going to be and begin to shape tunes
no,
to them?
No, no. This is a show that's being produced by Dick Adler, and I expect to be doing the score with Sheldon Harnick, who did Fiddler on the Roof, doing the lyrics. And when we get together, I'll know more about the collaboration.
Does the show have a title yet?
Yes, it's called Rex.
Sometimes shows are titled very late, aren't they?
Oh, sure.
Does that depend upon the lyricist, or?
No, it depends on whether you find a good one early.
I see. Do you research, would you research Henry VIII, for example, do you research any of the background for your shows, or is the book sufficient for you?
The book is sufficient, but I have a number of books on Henry VIII in my apartment. And I'm reading one of them right now. But this gives me background. I wouldn't call it research.
You don't have to worry about the period, for example, with respect to Henry VIII, for example. The period, I suppose, is today.
Well, it won't be today's music, and it certainly won't be Henry VIII's music. He wrote music, you know.
He did.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I imagine what it will be, if I'm lucky, is my impression of the way music sounded then, which won't attempt to be accurate.
Over the years, you and Hart and Hammerstein have made some remarkable innovations. You shaped the American musical theater. Do you see a major change coming about in musical theater programs, shows like Hair and so forth? Do you see it taking off in a different direction, or has the whole line from Jerome Kern through you and others, what we're likely to see in the future?
I don't know what we'll see in the future. I don't think it'll stay in the Hair tradition, because I don't think there's enough music in it. I don't think there's enough melody. I believe and I hope that the public want to hear tunes.
Tunes?
Yeah. But I can't be sure.
I think you have been and you will be. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim.